Happy Monday, everyone. Welcome. We're so glad that you're here, and we are enjoying the June gloom for one more day, and then it's going to be sunny again. We have sunshine in store for the rest of the week, so we're very happy about that. So hopefully things are, the weather is good in your neck of the woods. I know a lot of you are dealing with hail, rain, even smoke from the wildfires, heat already, and some a lot cooler than normal temperatures. So hang in there. Things have got to get better, and hopefully you've got your garden planted, and today we're going to be talking all about tomatoes. So it's going to be a fun one. Tomatoes are one of the most popular vegetables, and I think definitely one of my favorites. So if it's your favorite, raise your hand in the chat. And Jack is here from Maryland. Finally raining. I'm so glad to hear that, Jack. There was someone in the chat before the live stream started, I can't remember your name, was saying that Maryland's in a terrible drought, which I've heard, and that trying to keep the garden watered has been very challenging. So glad that it's raining. Hopefully it keeps up. Hopefully we all get some sunshine and kind of normal temperatures soon. So welcome. Really glad that you're here. Thanks so much for spending the Monday afternoon with us. And Mac, of course, has to make his little cameo down there running across the yard. And hopefully he stays out of trouble today during the live stream and doesn't start digging or chasing rabbits or anything like that. Although it's perfectly okay if he chases the rabbits and chases them out of the garden beds. Smart Pots is here. Welcome. Thunderstorms in Oklahoma City all week. Great to hear that, as long as there's no hail. Jackie, hi, welcome. So glad that you're here. Tracy M, greetings from the Inland Empire. More rain yesterday and today. We actually had some sprinkles yesterday, not too much, but really looking forward to some sunshine. So hopefully a lot of you SoCal gardeners are looking forward to that too. Debbie, welcome. Had some beautiful tomato plants growing, but quickly got covered with a leaf spot. Oh no, that's such a bummer. And many of the plants started dying. I'm really sorry to hear that. It's very disappointing when that happens. So hopefully you're able to get some more going. Eric, I missed the June gloom. Eric used to live here in Southern California. Eric from Smart Pots, 88 degrees and humid here in Pensacola. Yeah, definitely in the far south, in the deep south, you all are definitely getting into the dog days of summer. So we'll be giving some tips today for those of you struggling with heat and your tomatoes as well, that will hopefully be helpful. Sister Marcel, welcome. This year I'll be keeping on the pruning for single stem growing. So great tip on that one. That will really help kind of control your size of your tomato plant and also help you produce larger tomatoes. Your plants produce larger tomatoes. So so glad that you all are here. Let's jump into our tomato tips. Today, basically, we are troubleshooting common tomato problems and offering some simple fixes for them. There's so many issues that tomatoes can have. Although they're one of the most popular vegetables, they're probably one of the vegetables that's the most prone to disease and can have all kinds of little idiosyncrasies about them. So if that's happened to you, no worries. It doesn't necessarily mean that you're doing something wrong. It's just kind of the way it goes with tomatoes. So kind of manage your expectations with that. They're definitely a beautiful vegetable to grow, and you can really start them off right by planting healthy plants, making sure that your soil has lots of good organic nutrients in it, and taking good care of them with nice deep watering. But just manage your expectations. It's pretty much inevitable. Tomatoes are going to have some problems throughout the growing season, so just expect it, and do yourself a favor, and you know, kind of anticipate what things might happen, and have a few of these quick fixes on hand, armed and ready to go, and that way, you know, you can maximize your best tomato season, and hopefully get lots of tomatoes grown in your garden this year. So it's not a comprehensive list today. I'm not listing all the tomato diseases or all the problems tomatoes can have, but it's kind of some of the ones that seem to pop up in my garden most often, and then how I've taken care of it. So I thought it might be really helpful to share those tips with you today so you can implement it in your garden too. So the first one that most gardeners have issues with at some point during the season on tomatoes, also happens pretty frequently on squash and watermelon, is blossom end rot. So if you don't know what it is, you may have noticed on some of your tomatoes or your squash or watermelon, at the end or the bottom of the plant or of the fruit, sometimes there's kind of a brown, mushy type of spot that might kind of give a little bit when you push on it. That's basically blossom end rot. And it doesn't necessarily mean that the plant is is going, or the tomato plant, the tomato itself is inedible or is going to die. It definitely could, but it's not a very pretty thing to have on your tomatoes. And you do want to take care of it so that future tomatoes on that plant don't have that issue. So basically what's happening is the end of the tomato is rotting. And a lot of times that's due to uneven watering or a calcium deficiency. Excuse me. And it's very common, especially in container plants, because container plants can be a little bit tricky to water correctly. You know, when you water your containers, the water drains out the bottom. The nutrients tend to drain out the bottom pretty quickly. So you really have to stay on top of the watering and on top of the feeding for container plants. It's also a lot more common in Roma tomatoes for some reason. So one way that you can really help avoid it or fix it if your plant does have it is by really keeping your plants on a good, consistent watering schedule. So try and avoid letting your containers or your garden beds, for that matter, completely dry out and then soaking them down. You really want to keep a nice, even moisture so your plants don't dry out. Because what happens is a lot of times when your plants dry out, they don't have the moisture they need to be able to uptake the calcium from the soil, so they end up becoming calcium deficient. So, you know, it could definitely be a calcium deficiency in the plant itself, but oftentimes, if you correct the watering issues, you're gonna correct the blossom end rot. So a couple little tips on that is, if at all possible, install drip irrigation in your containers or your garden beds. If you're not in an area where you get very consistent rain, or even if you are, it just really helps keep your plants on a schedule. And really, consistent watering is really the key to a lot of great things in your garden, a lot of produce coming on, a lot of healthier plants coming on. So keep that watering consistent, and drip just takes the guesswork out of it. I know I've talked about drip over and over again, but it's truly a lifesaver and allows you to be able to go on vacation, to be able to forget to water your plants if you're trying to hand water, allows you to be able to be busy and not get out to your garden to water because you put it on a timer, you set it, and then you forget it. I mean, you don't quite forget it because you do still want to check and adjust your drip during periods of heat or when you're getting a lot of moisture to kind of adjust the schedule. But it definitely solves a lot of problems. It really does help. Laura is saying, Kelly Kim, it really, really does. So yeah, I know you may have installing drip off for a long time, or maybe you're not able to, but something you're putting off because you're a little intimidated by maybe the work that's involved or getting it installed, or feel like maybe it's just too costly for you, I really want to encourage you to make the investment in your garden. You can pick up a raised bed drip kit. I know they have them over at Home Depot, the same kind I use. It's called Dig is the brand I use. It used to be around $35 to $40. It may have gone up by now, but I've got links in the video description, and everything is in the kit. So it really makes it easy for you to install a basic drip system, and then you can expand from there. And of course, I've got videos on how to do that. So if you're intimidated by it, I want to encourage you to start one step at a time, maybe get it installed in a couple of raised beds, and then you can expand to other areas of your garden after that. So that will, number one, really help with the blossom end rot. The other thing you can do is spray your plants with calcium nitrate just to kind of help it uptake or add calcium to your plants. There's lots of different types that you can even, I mean, people use Tums, crushed Tums, and put that in the soil, crushed eggshells. Eggshells take a little bit longer to be able to be immediately available to the plant. The calcium nitrate you can get in a liquid form, and generally things that are water soluble and liquids are much more easily or readily available to the plants. So it's one thing you can try as well, but I would just try and fix your watering issues to start with. And then hopefully when the next tomatoes start coming on, you're going to avoid that blossom end rot, or BER, a lot of people call it for short, on the end of your tomato. So give that a try. And then I'd love to hear either next week or over the next few weeks, or either on my Instagram or email me if that is working for you. Now, if you do have a tomato with blossom end rot, What you can do is I would go ahead, if it's ripe or partially turning, I would go ahead and bring it in the house and just cut off that blossom end rot spot, that mushy spot. And a lot of times the tomato is still edible unless you've gotten like bugs in there or something like that. But a lot of times you can still eat the tomato and enjoy it. So give that a go and then make sure you come back and let us know. So I would love to hear in the chat if anyone else has had that issue and how you've dealt with it in the past, because we're all here to learn from each other, which is a pretty cool thing about this garden community, is everyone is just pitching in and offering their tips and tricks and how we can all learn from each other and really encourage and support each other. So let's hear what's going on in your garden. Terry is saying, I already had to pull two of the tiny Tim plants that weren't thriving. They just looked dry and the flowers were falling off. Luckily, I listened to Kim and planted several in succession, so I still have one. So yes, that's a great idea, is always have some backups going. The tiny Tims are great because you can start them indoors. They don't take up a ton of space, and you can get those planted in succession throughout the summertime. If you have room, I've got a whole bunch on the side of my house that I don't, a whole bunch of tomato seedlings that I don't have room to plant in the garden. They're quickly outgrowing their 1 gallon pots. So I would love to find a couple, maybe a couple 5 gallon pots. I can kind of keep them in a holding pattern in case I need to pop them in the garden if something happens to some of my bigger plants. Jack, raining hard here and I can just hear all the plants soaking it up. I've never been so excited for rain. The drought is crazy. Jack, I can totally relate to that. That's exactly what we've been going through that for the past several years here. And when it first started to rain back in December, we were so excited. You guys probably remember our videos. We had our rain barrel filling up. We had our rain gauge filling up. And we actually got to the point, it rained so much this year, we got a little bit sick of it. We were ready for the it to stop raining. So crazy enough, you know, we're very thankful for it, but we are kind of glad that now we're just getting some drizzles and hopefully we'll get some sunshine. So Jack, hope the garden soaks it up, because I don't know if you have drip or not, because you get so much rain. So I'm sure your garden will really benefit. There's something about the natural minerals and nutrients in the rain that almost immediately green up the garden. So cool. Okay, days in my life. Question, can tomatoes be in a 3 gallon grow bag? You know what? I would actually, I would only grow a dwarf tomato in a grow bag, 5 gallons, 3 gallons might be pushing it just a little bit, but you could probably do that. A dwarf tomato only. Tomatoes have really big roots, really extensive root system. And if you're going to grow a full size plant, that's just not going to be enough room. You're really not going to get a lot of tomatoes out of it because the roots don't have enough room to grow and thrive. So for a larger plant, you know, like an indeterminate variety or just a larger size tomato, even a large determinate variety, I would definitely go with at least a 10 gallon, even on up to a 20 gallon. You can grab the 10 gallons over at calikimgardenandhome.com. The 20 gallons you can, or bigger, you can grab over at Smart Pots. Smart Pots is here today. So thanks for being here, Smart Pots. And they've got all kinds of sizes of Smart Pots over there. You can get a 10% discount with the code CALIKIM. But the 10 gallons work great. I have lots of full-size tomatoes growing in those, and I think you'll get a lot out of them. And you can get 20% off those at calikimgardenandhome.com if you use the code FLOWER, and that sale is gonna end tomorrow, actually. Okay, so let's head into our second fix here, or issue, that is probably one of the biggest issues that most gardeners have throughout the growing season, including me. And if you saw my Instagram, you might know what that is already. And that is yellowing leaves. Yellowing leaves with or without brown spots. And there can be all kinds of causes to yellowing leaves. It can either be too much water, not enough water. It can be some type of disease, maybe getting a hold of your plant. It can be environmental stress. It can be a lack of some type of nutrient, like I just blanked out, like nitrogen, there we go. So there's lots of different causes. So you kind of have to assess what's going on with your tomato plant and then kind of pick one and see if you can correct it from there. I actually pruned off a whole bunch of yellowing leaves from my yellow pear tomato plant this morning. And so far, it's really the only one I have so far that's got a pretty good amount of yellowing leaves. And I don't have the plant right next to me at the moment, but looks something like this. So this one actually does have some spots on the leaves. Maybe you guys can see that, which to me is an indication of some type of disease. So anytime I see yellowing leaves, the fix for that is to immediately prune them off, because it can really spread quickly, not only to the same plant, to that plant itself, but also to neighboring plants. So my job for this afternoon is to go throughout my garden and just take a look at all my plants, do a little assessment. I noticed a lot of yellowing leaves on this one, but I might have them on others. So I'm gonna go ahead and prune all those off. And I do like to try and catch it as soon as possible, because like I said, it can spread typically from the bottom up. So it really does help, control the spread of the disease. It could be blight, early blight. It could be some type of leaf spot. There's so many different kinds of diseases. But I, rather than trying to diagnose the specific disease, I just go ahead and trim it off. Now, if I'm overwatering my plant and my soil is super soggy, it could just be that it's a matter of overwatering. So I want to back off on the water, only water when my plants need it. Maybe I've gotten a lot of rain that week or whatever, and I left my drip irrigation on for too long or something like that. I would back off, and that will help correct the problem and help correct the yellowing leaves. If you haven't fertilized your tomatoes for a while, especially your container tomatoes, it could be a lack of nutrients. So my recommendation for fertilizing container tomatoes especially is every 7 to 10 days. Realistically, I probably do mine every 10 days to 2 weeks. I like to keep my raised beds fertilized about once a month. So it could just be they need a good little dose of some nitrogen to help green up the plant. The Vermistura Vitality is great for struggling plants. It's like a supercharged worm casting that you can add to in liquid form that you can add to water, and it really helps boost the nutrients in the plant. So struggling plants, Vermistura Vitality works great. So this afternoon, I'll probably give this one a dose of the Vitality along with some fish fertilizer to really kind of help give it that good dose of nutrients. So again, yellowing leaves, a big problem. You want to prune them off to really help stave off the disease. I noticed a huge difference last year because I was very, very religious about going around my garden probably every 2 to 3 days and checking for yellowing leaves. And it really did help control the disease until later on in the season. So typically later in the season, your plants will get some type of disease. It's just the way it goes. Again, manage your expectations, expect it, especially if you have some environmental extreme weather like most of us have had. So temperature swings can do that. Later in the season, the plants are just kind of wearing out. And, as fall approaches and the weather cools off, your plants will definitely be getting yellowing leaves. And that's just part of the way it goes. The other thing is that I definitely should mention here is for determinate tomatoes. Those are tomatoes that are smaller, generally smaller varieties. They usually grow to a set size, produce their crop. For some reason, there's tons of planes flying over today. I hope you guys aren't hearing all those, but man, they're just going back and forth. Hopefully the background noise isn't picking it up. So determinate tomatoes produce their crop and then tend to die off. So, if your determinate tomatoes are looking pretty bad later, after they produce and everything, that's just part of the genetics. So I don't spend a lot of time trimming my determinate tomatoes. It's mainly your indeterminates that you need to be worrying about this with. But as they're growing and producing, if they are getting yellowing leaves, trim them off. But once they're done, they're probably just going to die off soon. So don't worry about that too much. Always, though, have a new round going, so that, you've got tomatoes to pop in their place once they're done. Okay, Gardener Tom has a great, great tip here. And Gardener Tom says, I try to head off disease by spraying with water and uncoated aspirin and with hydrogen peroxide. I do this about every 2 to 3 weeks, and it really, really helps with the disease. So great, great tip there. And those are things that most of you probably have at home right now, and would be a great thing to give that a go with your tomatoes. A little caveat there, always make sure you do a test spray. Spray one or two leaves or branches of a particular plant. Spray in the morning when it's cooler out, when not in direct sunlight, and then wait a day or so and make sure that everything is going well, your plant still looks good, before you spray the entire plant down. You know, different types of plants react differently, and different temperatures react, your sprays will react differently under different temperatures. So extreme heat, the plant may react a lot differently to a spray than in a cooler, cloudy day like today. So really great tip there, Gardener Tom. I really appreciate that. And Josh Hensley, thank you for being here today. And the question is, what is your favorite variety of indeterminate? I'd say probably my favorite is, I'm going to say the green zebra. I love Aunt Ruby's German Green and the Golden Jubilee. Those are probably three of my favorites. They really are beautiful and just super full of flavor, and I love to chop them up and make a pico de gallo, like fresh salsa with them. So good question, and hopefully I will have some of those coming on soon. Tomatoes are growing very slowly for me this year though, guys. I'm probably about at least 4 to 6 weeks behind where I normally am at this time of the year, just due to the weather. I don't think we've had a day over 70, maybe not even a sunny day or two, maybe just a few in about 2 to 3 weeks. So a really, really unusual start to the summer for us here in Southern California. So maybe a super late harvest for my tomatoes. Hopefully a lot of you are having tomatoes coming on and we can live vicariously through all your tomatoes. Okay, let me talk about the next tip here. Joyce has been harvesting tomatoes out the yazoo. Wow, that's awesome. I'm really happy for you, and hopefully a lot of the rest of you are too. And you know what? I keep telling myself, it's not a race. We're not like in competition with anybody else. We're just here to harvest things from our garden. Hopefully we have some veggies to enjoy and enjoy, you know, sharing all of our tips here in the live stream as we go throughout the season here. Okay, I see a lot of questions. Oh, you know what? One thing I did forget to mention about the yellowing is trellis your plants if you haven't yet. Put your tomato plants in cages. Keeps them off the ground, keeps the airflow going, helps avoid the disease. And I do prune about the bottom 6 inches of the leaves off my plants, my indeterminate plants. And that really does help kind of keep the plant drier, helps prevent the leaves from getting wet and staying wet, unless of course you're getting rain and water at the bottom. And that really does help kind of stave off the diseases in your plants. So lots of tips. Just take one or two of them, implement it in your garden. Don't feel like you have to do everything all at once. Just take one thing at a time and one day at a time in your garden and you'll be good to go. Okay, big problem number three, and I do see a lot of people talking about this here, is the flowers are drying up and dropping off. So that can definitely be a problem, especially in the summertime. And the main reason for that is because of high temperatures. Can definitely happen with big temperature swings as well. But for the most part, it happens when temperatures get above 90 degrees. The plants are just trying to stay alive, right? They're getting stressed out. They don't like the heat any more than we do. So typically what happens then is the flowers dry up and drop off. So if you've ever, you know, one day your plant looks absolutely beautiful, has tons of flowers on it, you're hoping for tomato fruit to start growing soon. The next day you have a heat wave and all your flowers are gone. That's pretty much what happened. It just did not like the heat. So really do pay attention to that weather forecast. I know it's crazy temperatures everywhere and you may be having some big temperature swings. So just expect it this summer. It's going to be kind of nuts with the weather. So take a look at your weather, and when you see temperatures over 90 degrees, I highly recommend using shade cloth to cover your plants. Tomatoes, peppers, squash can take the heat a little bit more, cucumbers can take the heat a little bit more, but the peppers and the tomatoes do tend to really, the blossoms do tend to drop off in the heat. So if you've never used shade cloth, it is one of your garden best friends. It's a lifesaver. So what will happen is, instead of your plants just trying to deal with the stress of the heat, they're going to stay about 10 to 15 degrees cooler under that shade cloth. So 90 degrees outside, 95 degrees outside, it's going to be 75 or 80 under that shade cloth. World of difference. I've actually done a test with a thermometer under the shade cloth, and it really is about 10 to 15 degrees cooler. Now, people ask me all the time, what level of shea cloth, what percentage of shea cloth, I should say. There's lots of different kinds out there. And I just get mine on Amazon. I found that's where it's the cheapest. You can definitely buy it at the garden center if you're in an emergency and need to get it right away. But I have lots of different kinds. And it doesn't really matter if it's black or tan or light colored. I found that different colors all tend to work the same. This is, I believe it's about a 40%. A shade cloth, and you can see, you know, it's pretty decent sized holes through here. But basically you lay this over your plant, you can drape it over your tomato cage, you can wrap it around and clip it on. I like to put it on this side that's kind of facing the sun, you know, for the majority of the day, especially in the afternoon heat. If you're limited with your shade cloth, that's when it tends to get the hottest. So you can wrap it around your tomato cage, drape it over your plant, super easy. Doesn't have to be like a permanent shade cloth structure. I actually got a lot of those little binder clips. You can get it like Staples or whatever, very inexpensive, and just clip that onto my tomato cages. Super easy. So if your temperatures aren't like super duper hot, like in the 90s, this will probably be sufficient. But if you really want to protect your plants, and I know some people live in areas where, you know, you consistently get over 100 degrees like all summer, and maybe you want to put up a more kind of permanent type of shade cloth structure, but this one here works really well, you know, especially the temperatures are going to be hot for a long time, or if it's super duper hot, like over 100, this is more of like a 60% shade cloth, lighter colored, and you can see how much tighter the weave is. So not as many of the sun's rays will get through, but it will still get light with the shade cloth. So both of these have worked great for me in the past. I've actually got my whole little storage shed over here, my garden shed, a whole shelf just dedicated to shade cloth of different sizes. And then I kind of try and remember like which pieces of shade cloth go over which garden beds because they fit the best and that type of thing. So you'll kind of get it down. But I would definitely get some shade cloth in your garden arsenal. And in Texas, already in the high 90s there. So she leaves a lot of her shade cloth up for most of the summer, and it really is a lifesaver. It can make the difference between you gardening, being able to grow something. It's actually just starting to sprinkle a little bit, between being able to grow something in the summer and not grow something in the summer. And it definitely may, you may not be able to grow everything, but it definitely, or shade everything, but it may definitely help you shade some of your favorite plants and keep them going and even producing during the heat. So I want to know in the chat, has anybody have shade cloth up yet? Has anybody planning on using it this year that never has? I talk about shade cloth a lot, but some people still don't know about it, and it really is super, super helpful. So I always like to mention it because it will save a lot of time, save your tomatoes or peppers. Okay, Nisha says, likes the black shade cloth. It works best when it's 95 degrees plus. So yeah, great tip there. Try different things, different types of shade cloth, see what works for you. And I probably have 3 or 4 different kinds, and then just hang on to it and pull it out whenever I need it, keep it accessible. It's also very helpful when you're first transplanting your vegetables to kind of give them a little bit of a break and kind of baby them along a little bit until their roots get established. So I see a great question here that I meant to mention. So thank you, Anne, for bringing that up. Anne says, how long do you leave shade cloth on? Does the plant get 40 or 60% sun then with your 2 suggestions? Okay, great question, Anne. I leave it on until the temperatures drop down between below 90 degrees. So this is kind of my general rule of thumb. And what it does for the 40% block, it actually blocks out 40% of the sun's rays. It's a more porous holes here, so it blocks out less. And then you can see the lighter colored one is more tightly woven holes, so it will block out up to 60% of the sun's rays. So when you're looking at shade cloth on Amazon, they have such a wide range. I mean, they have 90% that you can put like in your patio covers or whatever. You might have seen that. And I definitely wouldn't go that high over your garden because that's going to block out most of the sun. So anywhere between 40 to 60 usually is where I try and stay. But you know what? It's not a hard and fast rule. So just kind of, you know, grab yourself some shade cloth, and anything is going to be better than nothing in a heat wave. In fact, if you don't have shade cloth and your temperatures are really getting up there, you can even grab an old bed sheet, some sheer curtains, anything you can use just to cover your plants to protect protect them during that heat wave. They might not get sun for a couple of days, but it's better than them dying, right? So just do what you can to protect your plants and get them through those hot days, just like us. You know, sometimes we just stay out of the sun when it's in when it's 100 degrees. Sometimes we can sit under an umbrella and we're okay. So just do the best you can and make it work for your situation. And just keep in mind that you may lose a few plants. I mean, that happens to all of us. It happens to me. And that's just kind of the way it goes. So again, have those backups going. And that way you can kind of manage your expectations and not be quite so disappointed if something does happen. Okay, Julia, planning to use shea cloth this year. That's great. Make sure you come back and let us know what impact it has on your plants and on your garden. Okay, Connie, I tried 45% in the Texas summer. Didn't help a lot, so I put up 90%, did great. Great feedback there, Connie. I really appreciate you throwing that in there. And the Texas heat is super intense, so perhaps the 90 degree would work really well there. So that's a perfect example of experimenting. Didn't work, so you tried something else. Everybody's climate is different. Different things will work with for different people. And Sharon wants to know where to buy good shea cloth. I've got links in the video description, and they also usually have it at most garden centers. So, you know, you can look through those links or at your garden center and hopefully find one that will work really well for you. Okay, next tomato issue that a lot of people have, not everyone, and some years are a lot worse than others for this one, is a tomato hornworm. So hands up in the chat here if that's been an issue for you. It's kind of funny because one year I might pick 5 hornworms off, and another year I might pick 30 off in a couple of days. And if you've never seen the tomato hornworm, well, you're in for a maybe not so great of a treat if you haven't seen it. It's a huge worm. It can be a couple inches long when it grows up a little bit or when it eats more of your tomato plant. And it does have little horns at the top of its head. So it's actually a really beautiful worm. But the only problem is it is very, very destructive, super destructive. It'll latch onto your plant and will actually grow, you know, the eggs get deposited onto your plant, the hornworm hatches and grows, and then it will eat away your plant literally like overnight. So it's not something that you want in your garden necessarily. It does turn into a beautiful sphinx moth. So it is a really beautiful moth, but I don't really want it to stick around my garden long enough to see that because it will destroy my tomato plant. One thing you want to look out for, it's a real sign of the tomato hornworm. They're green. They blend into your plant. They're super hard to spot. Just, you know, on the fly walking by your plant, it's not something you're just gonna, oh yeah, there's a tomato hornworm. But what you can see is they're droppings. So they have, you know, pretty good size droppings that you might see. Black, you know, not like as big as like a rabbit dropping or anything, but small little droppings, larger than, you know, the teeny tiny cabbage loopers. But you're gonna see those maybe on your plant. And when you do see that, that's a sign that the hornworm is around somewhere. So take a look at your plant, inspect it very carefully, you know, on top of the leaves, on the stems, it's probably crawling around somewhere. And then honestly, the best method I found, and I know a lot of people, you know, they don't like to do this, but I usually put a glove on because I don't really like to touch them. Pull it off with the glove. If you have chickens, the chickens love them, or you can drop it like in a bucket of soapy water or just throw it in the green bin. Sometimes I'll be pruning my tomato plants at the same time, find some tomato hornworms, and I'll just throw them in a 5-gallon bucket and put the whole thing in the green bin, which our trash company picks up once a week, and that way they can be in the green bin and munch away to their heart's delight until they get taken out with the trash. So I don't use soapy water a whole lot, but you can definitely do that if you want. There is also, if you're really having a big problem, you can use something called BT, and there's lots of BT products out there. It's for organic gardening. Bonide has a great BT spray, and that does really, really help. You can find that, where to buy that, over at bonide.com. But let me know, I've never actually used BT, so let me know in the chat if you have, or what your method is for using it. Now, Terry, I'm surprised that you already picked off 2 of them. For some reason, I don't typically have them until later in the year, so I better keep an eye out, because it could be a clue that maybe they're here in Southern California just a little bit early. Usually it's July or August when I start to notice them. So yeah, let me know here in the chat if you have seen them, and what you use to get rid of them. Okay, so Tracy says, I've seen those. They were on my carrots. Wow, I've never had them on carrots before, and totally destroyed my black nebulas. Beautiful worm, neon green, but destructive. Yeah, they are kind of strangely beautiful, but most gardeners call it the dreaded hornworm. So keep an eye out. If you're not aware of those yet, definitely be aware that they may be visiting your garden, or they might not, but it's always good to be aware of them. Okay, let's see, 808 Ladybug. Terrence puts our bugs in the green waste bin too. Yeah, definitely. It's not too fun to squish them because they're so large, and you know, that way they can kind of eat away and have fun in the green bin until the trash picks them up. Okay, let's see here. Any other comments here about the dreaded tomato hornworm? Thank you very much, TNB Naturals. Love the channel. Welcome. I'm glad that you're here. And V, last season I kept one worm as a pet. That's right, I remember that. And I gave gave volunteer plant tomatoes. It was big and fat. I bet it was probably super big and fat, eating off your tomatoes. And that would be kind of a fun experiment. They're usually pretty small when they start out, and then they do definitely get big and fat the more of your tomato plant they eat. So stay on top of it, and it is pretty easy to, you know, unless it gets out of hand, to keep it under control. Michigan Mike, thank you so much. Kim, your backyard looks amazing. I've not seen it since you and the hubby redid it. Shade cloth is always used here in Michigan. Very important. The hornworms work awesome on my fishing hooks. Wow, that's great. So if you're a fisherman, that might be something you want to hang on to. Have a little hornworm coffee can or whatever you do to take out fishing. It might really come in handy there. So, and thanks so much, Mike, for the compliment on the yard. For those of you that don't know, we just actually redid this portion of our deck here, and we're waiting for our railing to come in. We got like a cable railing kit we're going to put together, which will allow us more view of the garden, but for now we don't have a railing. So I thought it's fun to live stream the past few weeks here to give you guys a nice view of the garden. And you know, I'm pretty far from the edge here, so don't worry, I'm not gonna walk backwards or anything, but we are really careful around the edge of the deck, but excited to get that new railing installed. So thank you very much. Okay, let's move on here. Tip number five that probably most people will have a problem with is tomato cracking. Let me just see how many tips I have. I forgot. Okay, I've got six. So tomato cracking is generally a problem for most gardeners at some point. Yeah, 808 Ladybug, I am really careful around the edge, and I'm actually about 2 or 3 feet away, so I'm pretty good. It might look closer than it is. Is tomato cracking. So a typical tomato problem, and again, doesn't necessarily mean you did anything wrong. It just kind of happens. It can happen when you're getting lots and lots of rain, or when you overwater. That's probably the most typical causes of tomato cracking. And you might see two different types of cracks on your tomatoes. One is called, make sure I have the name right, it's called radial cracking, and that is when your tomato will crack kind of down the sides. And that's pretty typical if you have a lot of rain all of a sudden and your plants are just getting way too wet. Basically, the plants are kind of growing, and they're filling up with water, and they're not able to contain themselves within the skins, and they crack. So that's one type of cracking. The other type is called concentric, and a lot of you might have seen this too. It's just little circles that kind of go around your tomato, and you know, that can be caused by actually any of them can be caused by overwatering or by environmental changes. It can also happen if things get really hot. If the weather gets really hot, because the tomato is basically boiling in its skin and then cracking either down the side or around the middle. So the big thing with cracking is that you want to, if the tomatoes have started to turn a little bit, like turn color, you do want to take those tomatoes off the vine, because the cracking can introduce bacteria, can introduce bugs into the tomato, and you definitely don't want that. But if they have started to turn, you can bring them inside and ripen them off the vine, which gives you a much better chance of being able to eat them before they rot or before they get infested with bugs. So a really super easy way to do this is to bring them inside. You can put them inside a paper bag that helps them ripen a little bit quicker. or just set them on your countertop. You don't want to put them on a sunny window because that might make them rot a little bit quicker. But I found the best way to do it is just to pop them in a little paper bag, or if you have a lot of them, put them in a cardboard box and line it with newspaper, like in between layers of newspaper, and that'll just help them ripen a lot quicker. But usually you can help correct that problem. If it's heavy rain, that'll be a little more difficult. But if you're overwatering, back off on your watering, especially when they're starting to ripen, and that will help reduce the cracking. So kind of keep an eye on that. And then, you know, you can troubleshoot it and apply one of those little fixes there so that you can still eat those tomatoes that are either cracking or and avoid it for the next time. So heavy rain's a tough one. Do make sure that your drip irrigation is off if you're getting a lot of rain, but if you are and the rain's just not stopping, you may have a lot of cracking issues this year. So just be aware of that. And then maybe you can ripen them before they, you know, get rotten or get bugs in them. So a little tip there. Let me know if you've ever dealt with that and what you've done to help fix it or prevent it. Okay, V, yes, we are all still learning with our irrigation. It's kind of a trial and error method, especially when you first start with your drip. You just kind of pay attention to what the weather's doing and then need to reduce your frequency based on that. We have been so cool this year. I've had to turn off my drip several times because it's just been getting a little bit too much water. When you've got cloudy days for 2 weeks in a row, your garden doesn't need a ton. And, you know, you're getting rain here and there. So I put my drip on rain delay, I think for 3 or 4 days last week. So to avoid the overwatering issue. So definitely always experimenting and learning with that one too. Heather, how are you, Heather? Great to have you here today. I had a bunch of my large tomatoes crack this year. Okay, so Heather, hopefully you'll be able to correct that problem or bring them in to ripen inside and still get some to eat there. Okay, let's see here. Kiki, growing Romas in a food grade bucket. If there are a few tomatoes that are already red and reflecting blossom end rot, but most still green, doing well, only cut off the dead ones. Yeah, I would go ahead and take those off that are getting blossom end rot. The other ones will probably do fine if you can make sure that you're getting consistent water. Take the blossom end rot ones off, correct the problem, and hope you'll have better luck as the green ones grow. So good luck with that one. Okay, we've got one more tip, and this is one that I get almost every year. We'll see how it goes this year. And that is leaf curl on your tomato plants. So often you might see your tomato plants, the leaves kind of curling up, curling inward actually. And that can be kind of disconcerting because you think, oh my goodness, it looked great yesterday. What in the world happened? Should I prune those plants, those leaves off? My leaves are looking a little bit leathery. They're not looking, they might be green, but they're just kind of have a leathery, strange appearance. Maybe they're thickening a little bit. A lot of times that's caused by environmental stress. So because our temperatures are all over the place this year, a lot of you might have issues with that, either by temperature swings, like really cold one day, really hot the next day. Typically for us here, it's because of heat. All of a sudden it just gets really, really hot. And typically that problem does kind of correct itself as the temperature evens out. You do, again, want to make sure that your tomato plants are getting consistent moisture. And, you know, leaf curl does not usually affect the plant's growth or the plant's production. So just keep that in mind and don't go crazy pruning those leaves off. You really don't need to do anything except for making sure that it's getting good, consistent water. So there's not much we can do about the weather. I mean, God controls the weather. We don't control it. So, you know, just buckle down and do the best you can with the temperature that you're having and then make adjustments, you know, protect your plants with the heat, make sure that you're keeping your watering very consistent, and tomatoes do like really deep watering as well. You do want to make sure that you have well-draining soil. I think that's a really important thing. Some people, when they plant in containers, will maybe grab some garden soil from, you know, the corner of your yard or whatever. And I don't like to do that just myself personally, because I do have really heavy clay soil. And what I found is garden soil just doesn't drain as well as when you're making a really nice potting mix or getting a really nice potting mix from the garden center. So either make your own, buy a good organic mix if you don't want to make your own, and do make sure that your soil is really well draining. And that will really help just give your tomatoes even watering, keep them healthy, help them from getting their roots rotting, and give them their roots lots of nice oxygen to grow. So it definitely does help. Okay, guys, those are the 6 tips I had for today to troubleshoot your tomato issues. Hopefully it was helpful. I would love to hear in the chat in the last few minutes any other particular issues that you might have with your tomatoes and how you fix them. And please head over to my Instagram at Callie Kim, at KellieKim29, and make a comment on the reel I posted this morning about yellowing leaves. And do feel free to make comments over there as well, as far as what issues you're having with your tomatoes and how you fix them. Because that's what we're all about here, right? Is just hanging out, having fun, growing our gardens, providing support, and answering questions. And we can all work at this together. Okay, Terry, leaf miners are my biggest pest so far. I forgot to mention leaf miners. Yeah, and that's one of those things too. Sometimes it's a bad leaf miner year, sometimes it's okay. Leaf miners are tricky though, because they get in the leaves themselves, inside the leaves, and mine their way through the leaves. So if you've never seen them, they kind of make little tracks on the leaves, but they're inside the leaves. So the eggs kind of hatch, and then the leaf miners burrow their way in. I do, when I see leaf miner tracks, I cut them, or a leaf miner damage to my leaves. For some reason, they get on my dahlias this year. They've been on my dahlias quite a bit. I do trim the leaves off right away. And I've been spraying everything with the Bonide Neem Max whenever I have issues, or even before I have issues. And that's really nice, because it's a 4-in-1 kind of pest control. It helps with, it's a fungicide. It helps with spider mites, and it's a nematicide. So that's one thing I've been using all over my garden to help with the pests. But you have to catch the leaf miners before they burrow into the leaves to really be effective. So it's a good thing to do a preventative spray with something like that if that's an issue for you in your garden. Okay, guys, we are going to sign off for today. And I just realized I forgot to mention our sale on our website, 20% off with the code FLOWER. Ends tomorrow. You get a free purple coneflower seed packet with your order. And it's all about the seed collections for that one, the garden kits, the books, and the Callie Kim Smart Pots. It's also the last day for the $7 off the June Grow Your Groceries with Callie Kim subscription box. It's a really good discount on that. The code for that is Summer Salad Station. We've got heat tolerant greens in here, so you can keep growing your salads all summer long. And that sale also ends tomorrow. And these are almost sold out for the month. So if you want one, I would highly suggest you grab it with the Summer Salad Station discount before they run out. Hope you guys have a great week. Be on the lookout for a couple more videos from us this week. And we will be back next Monday. Oops, Jerry's down there. I didn't see him down there. Sorry, Jerry. I was blocking the view there.
Hey, everyone. Thanks for joining.
Say hi to Jerry and Mac down there, and we'll look forward to seeing you on next Monday's live stream right back here at noon Pacific time. All right, guys, have a great week and stay safe, and make sure you grow, harvest, and eat to your heart's delight. All right, bye-bye.